and the free, I don't know, I don't know. 'Twas Christy Columbus is what they tell me, maybe so, I don't know. There's only one Christy that I know at all, one Christy that I ever saw. He's the one who discovered the fadeaway ball, and he pitches for Muggsy McGraw.
First, there is no smoking at all in the theater per fire marshal. If you wish to smoke at intermission, please do so out front. And in case of an emergency, we have our emergency exit, which is the way you came in, and an additional exit if we need to behind the set and out the door over in the corner. So, and the other thing I'd like to mention to you is that we are going to be sending some money off to the Negro Baseball Museum, which is opening up its new house in about a week, I believe. And a few of our cast members are going to go and bring a check. And there's a basket out in the lobby if you'd like to make an additional contribution. And they'll be telling you more about that at the end of the show. So enjoy.
The way you think, the world you live in, all of it. shaped by men like me. We did our work in boardrooms, on Wall Street, in the White House, hell, even on a sports field. You think it's your national pastime? It isn't. It's mine. At the turn of the century, I took a rustic folk art form called baseball and applied the science of warfare to it. Fit like a damn glove, you gotta believe. That's my contribution to America. That's what you owe me. I know these things for three reasons. I'm dead, I'm a millionaire, and I'm in the Hall of Fame. You're trying to forget me, aren't you? You're trying to forget me. You're trying to forget.
When I was 16, I helped a doctor take a bullet out of a nigger some white boy had shot. I was trying to decide if I wanted to go into medicine. Dr. Moss had me give the boy chloroform to feel around the inside of him. He found a bullet. Couldn't though. But neither could Dr. Moss. We sold him up at the end. He lived okay, I guess. My hands were covered in his blood. I felt awful. Lord, I wanted to faint and throw up all at the same time. Never became a doctor. I guess you can see that. But even so, blood has had a way of following me around, I suppose. This here is the uniform of the Royston Reds of Royston, Georgia. When I was 14, I played my first game for them. You know, 8 chances without an error. Made 3 hits. Anyone who ever saw me play, ever, knew I was destined. I even made my own bats in the town coffin making shed. Used prime ash. Look at that. Baseball bat's a serious item. Now and again, I think how many times one of these been used to kill somebody. Well, it's a club, is what it is. Now, people use it that way in homes all over the nation. They club each other to death with the first thing comes to hand. I'm the greatest player ever lived, Ty Cobb. My name's been on a lot of bats, so it's been cup and blood, I suppose, its share of the time. It's no toy. And it's no game, neither. When I was 18, my mother killed my father.
There's no need to talk about it.
Babe Ruth was an orphan and America adopted him. My mother killed my father and no one wants to know me.
I told you don't talk about it. Talk about my swing instead.
Maybe you'd like to study my unique handbook. It's a secret to my success. Along with the fact that I'm the most talented man ever played.
Most talented?
See, I hold the hands apart. Then as I swing, I move one hand toward the other, depending if I'm hitting the right or the left. Now, if you never played the game before, you don't know what I'm talking about. And if you have, well, you can't do it as well as me anyway. So don't try to analyze it. Just remember, it's part of my myth.
A great myth needs a great beginning. It's like the advice I give young boys I'm teaching how to hit. First of all, get yourself a comfortable stance. It's my first rule for young ball players.
My mother took a lot. That's what some people said.
I said, don't talk.
Personally, I think it's a goddamn vicious lie, but they said it.
Whole town said it.
Liar. My father was W.H. Cobb. People called him professor, school commissioner, newspaper editor, state senator. When he was 21, he married my mother. And she was 12. What the hell is wrong with that? I was playing with the Augusta tourist in the salad. It was 1905. One night down in Royston, my father said he was going out to the farm for a couple days.
He wasn't, though.
This is hearsay. I heard all this later.
He took the buggy and left my mother alone in the house. My brother and sister were away in France. Later, Mama locked the windows upstairs in the bedroom.
Even though it was August in Georgia,
All hearsay. We'll never really know.
She was afraid of being alone. She went to bed.
About that time, somebody saw my father. He wasn't out at the farm, like you said. He was in town, just walking by himself. But he had a gun.
All this was years ago.
Little after midnight, my mother heard a noise outside the window, out in the porch roof. Someone was trying to open the window. She was all alone in the house.
She said she was alone. There was a gun in the room.
A shotgun.
That's not unusual.
Papa kept it there for times of danger.
She picked it up. She couldn't tell who was at the window.
Did she look?
She was afraid to look.
Maybe she already knew.
That's a heartless lie. How can you even think that?
I can't help what I think. Besides, there ain't no way of really knowing.
It's all conjecture.
Then think the best.
That's a good idea.
Why didn't you do anything? Tell me that. The window was locked.
Whoever it was could have smashed the window.
So she just fired? She didn't look? It could have been anybody.
That's right. It could have been anybody.
It was so long ago.
She was alone. She fired.
She said she was alone.
Later, she fired again. Not for a little while, people said. Not for a little while.
Outside the window, on the porch roof. With all that broken glass, that's where my father died.
He was shot in the stomach. In the head.
The neighbors ran over, and they found a gun in my father's pocket.
Well, fine. Now you've told it. Let's move on.
My mother was arrested, accused of voluntary manslaughter.
After the funeral, I stayed for about 4 days, listening to her tell her story. It never got any clearer. I mean, it made sense, sort of. And she was alone. I've been alone like that. But even so, what if there was a lover?
There was no lover!
Would you believe her?
I did!
And I didn't! Whatever the truth was, my mother killed my father, and anything I ever thought or said or did after that, knew that.
Son of a homicide. See, that's what I mean about a myth. It's got to have the right kind of style. Look at Beirut. He had a beautiful myth. In a home for wayward boys from the age of 7. His folks couldn't handle it. The priest became his second father. Boy, hero, rises from nothing. Horatio Alger couldn't have written it better.
Yes.
What did I have? Goddamn Greek tragedy. Where the hell was my second father? What do you think's in the bag? You can see what's on top of the bag. What do you think's in it? What would you have in it? $1 million in negotiable securities. The gun's real, by the way. Don't get any ideas. I had a touch of cancer. Prostate cancer at first. Cancer of everything else eventually. It climbed its way up my back into my brain. Took nearly 2 years. I fought it on my own, but finally the pain got too bad and I came here. They shot me full of drugs. I was unconscious for a few weeks. And I died. And dreamed.
Special.
You were an orderly?
Not exactly. Named Charleston.
Charleston?
That's right, Oscar Charleston.
Charleston?
Got to know some nice setup here, Mr. Cobb. Soft bed, nice quiet room, plenty of money. Looks like you died real good here.
Oscar Charleston, do I know you?
Hard to say who knows me. Very important to die good. It's your last thing. very last minute before. Well, before you know it. Man, you got some tight muscles.
Damn it, tell me who you are.
Look for yourself.
Ball player? You played ball?
More than 20 years.
You're not old enough.
Thought you'd like to see me in my prime. I'd be older if you want.
Charles, what position did you play?
Center field. Same as you. Sit back now. You're in so much comfort around here, you don't need to back up.
A ball player. Are we any good?
Better than you.
No one was better than me. Ow!
Sorry. Tell you the truth, I'm about the finest ever played. You can hit a ball on all fields. It was power. Run a fly ball down like it was a $100 bill. Folks said it was a privilege to see me play.
You're so good, why don't I know you?
You never would have played against me. Not back then.
Oscar Charles.
Here it comes back. Everything comes back. That's the truest thing I know. Feeling better?
What?
How's that?
Oh, feels good.
Thank you.
What?
I rubbed your back. Say thank you.
Oh. Thank you.
You're welcome. I'll be back later.
Wait a minute. Where are you going?
Don't worry, I'll be around.
Charleston, wait. Charleston.
One thing you can count on, I'll always be around.
Why don't I remember you? Who was that?
I don't know. I don't recall.
I was going to talk now.
What?
I was going to talk now, all right?
What about?
My money.
What? Yes, fine, good. Stick to the subject.
When I died, my estate was worth anywhere from $6 to $10 million. Depending on which self-interested son of a bitch you ask. I kept score with two things in life, with these and with money. Did just as well with both. Now tell me, what would you do if you were a young ball player in Detroit in the first 20 years of this century? You'd invest in General Motors, of course. My lord, it was like opening your door and having money pouring your house. And how many of my Tiger teammates made that same investment? The stupid sons of bitches could have been rich. I told them how. Ball players are the most ignorant class of creatures on the face of creation.
Except for sports writers.
I told them too. Might as well have asked them to invest in Bolshevism. In 1918, I invested in Coca-Cola. You think those sports writers would go into it?
Coca-Cola in 1918. Bet I was rich. I retired as the first millionaire ball player. Decades before anyone else did it.
Investing wasn't hard. Hitting the spitter was hard. Make money get hold of one simple thing and never let it go.
Self-made millionaire and an aging millionaire. That's what I was. That's my myth. You bet I was rich. I helped shape the American age. No one's going to forget that. You're not going to forget that. Well, where the hell are you?
What am I talking about?
About the uniform, damn it. What do you think?
Like this uniform? The Detroit Tigers are the last team to keep full collars on their shirts. It comes from a time when players wore ties, pitched underhand, and hit with flat bats. The game was half gentleman, half farm boy. Never really knew what it wanted to be. Till I came along. I was the quickest, meanest, smartest, fiercest, best man ever to play the game. I took baseball exactly like a man takes a wife. I made it mine.
For me, baseball was a virgin. When I was through,
Hebrew? It was American.
I was the first man ever swing three bats in the on-deck circle. Made the one bat feel lighter when I hit. The other Tigers thought I was trying to show them up. I wasn't. I was just getting ready to take their jobs. At least the ones I had down in Royston. Later on, my first year here, someone cut them all in half. For a joke. I had them for my first game, though. August 30th, 1905. We played the New York Highlanders, which is called the Yankees back then. Happy Jack Chesper was his pitcher, a spitballer. The year before, he won 41 games, which is a hell of a lot of spit. Bottom of the first inning, I got up with a man on third and two outs. And I stared out at that Hall of Fame pitcher. And he stared back at me like I wasn't there. Well, he threw the first pitch high, and I missed. And he started to smile. Then he threw a curveball, which broke right over the outside corner and froze my blood for strike two. And he moved up to a happy little grin. Old Jack was getting ready to laugh me right out of there. But I was calm as the Dead Sea. I knew this game was invented for me, and not for Happy Jack Chesbrough. So on the very next pitch, I swung again and lined a hard one to left center and took second on what right there would have been a single for any other man. And got the first run batted into my career all in the very same moment of time. And when Jack Chesbrough turned to look at me, standing on second, he was staring at his future. Not long after that, they started calling me the Georgia Peach.
Great name. A great myth needs a great name. I had a great name, Georgia Peach.
That was 3 weeks after my mother killed my father.
You know, you can't overstress the positive in baseball. Positive frame of mind, that's everything. That's why a great name is important. Georgia Peach, and perfection. I became perfection.
In the spring, they put my mother on trial.
Leave it alone.
Why?
There's no way to win with something like that.
Of course there is. It was a trial. Somebody wins, somebody loses. It wasn't long. Only lasted a couple of days. I tried to get there on time, but I couldn't.
I didn't want to.
That's a lie.
There's no need.
I stayed in spring training as long as I could. Who in hell wants to hear their mother testify about a thing like that?
I did.
Your mother wasn't out there.
I heard the final summations the next day. It lasted more than 5 hours. Then the jury retired. 1 hour later, they came back in. Not guilty.
Not guilty.
Not guilty.
Nobody during that whole trial ever once mentioned a lover.
There was no lover. She told me.
Over and over, she told me in her way. And did I believe her?
No!
A positive frame of mind. The most important thing in baseball. Now let's change the subject.
What?
I don't know. Guns. You're standing there with a big game rifle, for God's sake.
I grew up with guns. Got to hunt all my life. Shot game in the Tetons, California.
Hunting was very popular then.
You want me to talk or not? I shot bear, moose, caribou. Nothing compared with hunting. Once in Canada, I got lost. Wandered around that wilderness for 2 days till I found the railroad. Totally cut off from the world of men.
Best 2 days I ever spent.
Say that. It's not true.
What do you mean it's not true?
It's not. I liked being around people. Liked it a lot, didn't I?
I did, eh? Is that why I roomed alone so much on the road?
That wasn't other people. That was ball players. Because of the hazing my rookie year, that's all.
Channel. Hazing? Is that what you call it? They made me feel like an animal, didn't they?
the way then. You're there to replace one of them. They don't take kindly to it. Doesn't mean you hate all humanity.
Doesn't?
Season wasn't so bad. It was just the first season. First couple, maybe. They didn't do anything so bad, but what did they do? Lock me out of the hotel bathroom? Not speak to me?
Mail my shoes to the floor? Saw my bats in half. Attack me on the train.
It wasn't that bad. It was a team. It was...
I felt like an animal. Hell, I learned what team men meant them against me. I was humiliated every day by players not fit to stand on the same field with me.
Everybody else took it.
That wasn't everybody else. They could see that. Only made them more vicious.
You're concentrating on the wrong thing.
Tell them what I did. Tell them. Did the only thing a sane man would do. I bought a gun. Made a new rule for young ball players. Always keep a lethal weapon within reach.
No.
We're telling the truth here. We're talking about my life. It's going to be the truth.
Not all the truth. King.
All of it. Arguments, suspensions, facts.
What good will that do? That's not what people want to hear about.
It's all they want to hear about. I fought people. I don't mean shoving matches, I mean fights. Blood, bruises, broken bones. People laid up for days. Careers ended. I had fights.
On the field, he means. It was a kind of strategy.
Strategy? And not just on the field, fights.
Every man has fights. I mean, we wouldn't be human if we...
October 6, 1906.
Don't go into this.
October 6, 1906. Come on, it's who I was.
Have to be.
October 6, 1906, a low skunk pitcher, Ed Seymour, my own teammate, hit me from behind in a hotel lobby.
I decked him with one punch, then I hit him a few more on the jaw, and then I kicked him a few in the head for good measure.
I never kicked him.
I only kicked him a few.
I never kicked him.
How the hell do you know? You don't remember what happened.
What I remember is what happened. Don't you see how it works?
That night on the train, I lay awake in my berth, pistol in my hand.
Baseball was a team game. That was its only flaw.
March 1907.
Stop this.
I got blindsided by a homicidal catcher named Charlie Schmidt.
He didn't blindside me.
Oh, hell, he didn't. How else could that dumbass have got me on the ground?
Charlie Schmidt was nobody.
He was bigger than me.
What's that got to do with it?
Charlie Schmidt once fought Jack Johnson. For fun, he'd pound nails on the clubhouse floor with his fist.
He never hurt me. He broke my nose. He never
stop this.
Look at us. It's like a damn armory out here. Get rid of these. I never owned a gun in my life. That was a mistake, that fight with Charlie Schmidt. Happened off the field. It had nothing to do with science or strategy or anything useful. I've decided to disown it.
Disown it?
That's right. It's not worth recalling from the past, so it's no longer part of the past. Simple as that.
And that makes it disappear. It never happened.
Happened. It was a lot, someone told us.
You intend to just re-remember everything?
Not everything. I admit to plenty of fights. In games, fair fights, where I had a plan and a goal. Like, how about that time I crashed into that catcher and he dropped the ball and I scored?
Well, that's a hell of a fight. Me lying on the plate, him smacking me on my head.
But I scored. That's the point.
Why does that matter so much?
I got the best of it, somehow.
But why does that matter so much?
What do you mean?
Why does it matter who won? It was a fight. I fought. That's who I was.
No, I won. That's who I was.
What are you doing here?
Heard you talking about fights.
So what?
Don't want you to forget about old Bungie, that's all.
Bungie? You remember Bungie?
Color coach at spring training camp down in Augusta.
I never fought with Bungie.
Sure you did. Chased him all over the field that day. He came up to you drunk, kept calling you Carrie instead of your right name.
I don't remember that.
Carrie! Sam! Carrie! Instead of Cobb. Instead of Mr. Cobb.
I forget what I like.
Chased him all over the field, finally catching him by the clubhouse. His wife came out, started yelling at you to let him go.
Get him out of here.
Then you started choking him. Bungie's wife, you started choking him.
This is lies.
No, it ain't. They had to pull you away.
I don't even know who you are.
Choking a woman like that? You mazed everybody that day.
I didn't choke her hard.
Don't admit it.
I was just holding that, trying to keep her off me.
I believe you. You ain't got to convince me.
Why'd you bring this up?
I didn't want you to forget. It being preseason and all.
Who the hell are you anyway? Who?
Oscar Charleston, whoever that is.
You're probably thinking of me by a different name. That's why you don't remember. You need that key name. You think of that? You know who I am.
I will.
You should. World of baseball ain't that big after all. Still, it's hard to remember sometimes. Man gets old, memory gets smaller. Always mind keep working at it though. Goes over and over things like a guard in the army camp checking a perimeter wire. Round and round it goes checking.
But maybe, just maybe, someone's moving that wire in on him.
Maybe he doesn't even notice. That wire keeps moving in on him a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more.
I am not absent-minded.
I never said you were.
If I didn't know you, it's because I didn't need to know you. Didn't care to. You weren't important.
Got to admit, I always thought I was important. Oscar McKinley Charleston, born October 1896. Kelly was running for president. That's how I got a mountain for a middle name. I did think I was someone. Suppose we all do.
I was someone.
I know. Nothing changes that. Even if you do want to block me out of your mind.
I'm not blocking anybody out of anything. Now you get the hell out of
here. I know who he is. I remember him. Didn't want to say it. Oscar McKinley Charleston. He's the Black Cobb.
The Black Cobb?
The Black Cobb.
It's a pleasure to be recognized.
What the hell's he doing here anyway?
How should I know?
Black Cobb, I'll beat his damn head in!
No.
Why?
Leave him alone.
Why?
Because I say so.
All that stuff about Bungie, as though he never had any fights. What the hell's he doing here?
Mopping up.
Keep away from me, you hear?
There's no reason we have to pay attention to him. He's got nothing to say that's relevant anyhow. We'll just ignore him.
Ignore him?
That's right. A man who needs a name like that just to be remembered. I said ignore him.
You had to go and remember him.
Don't think about him and he'll go. It's as simple as that. Talk about something else, anything, it doesn't matter.
Fights?
No.
Yeah, fights.
All right, it'll keep our minds off. Go ahead, name a fight, any fight.
Any fight?
Not any fight.
May 15th, 1912.
Why that one?
Why not?
Something else, a different fight.
Why not that one?
Because I say so.
It's as good as any other. Hell, better.
I always get the worst of that one. Come off sounding like a monster.
Damn it, I'm me! May 15th, 1912. Put yourself in my place. For 7 years, you are the finest player in baseball. Better hitter, better runner, better fielder, better thinker than any man who's ever played the game. If an outfielder was slow throwing a ball in, I took an extra base. If someone got in my way, I knocked them down. If they blocked the base, I spiked them. If they wanted to fight over it, I fought them. Anyone! That was the bargain I made with baseball. I was destined to play a child's game all my life. At least I was going to play it like an adult.
Well, what he means is, I beat up a man.
There's no damn dignity in the game. None. When I started in the big leagues, they put fans right in the outfield with you. Just rope them all behind you like patrons at a movie theater. Someone hit a long fly ball, you'd have to go tearing through a bunch of strangers to get at it. Dangerous as hell. The owners didn't care.
And it was worse when you played away.
Think about it. 5,000 strangers standing right behind you, so close they can touch you. And all of them rooting for the other team.
They weren't the worst, though.
No, they weren't.
Worst ones were the ones who sit in the grandstand. They feel protected behind the railing like little kings. Them sitting, you standing up all day, the worst of the worst come back every game. Sit in the same place, shout the same violence, the same humiliations. I can think of no other art form than baseball. As I played, it was an art form in which ignoramuses are expected to scream insults in your face on a daily basis. Hell, Beethoven would kill a man for that.
What are they thinking when they shout those things? What's in their minds? What's in their hearts that make them need to pull a man down? It's anonymous. There's no real triumph in it. They shout from a crowd.
Well, they're cowards is all. I mean, we're all cowards. Only some of us do it in public.
Hey, Cobb! You.
Your mother can do everything better than you.
And she can do it more often.
With more people.
And she can make more money at it. Your mother. Your mother. Your mother.
They can't go too far.
But you bear it as much as possible anyway.
Until you can't anymore.
Until you can't anymore.
May 15th, 1912.
Claude Luca.
I won't even say his name.
A law clerk. Not even a clerk, a flunky.
New York. It always happens in New York. That city was made for dishonorable encounters.
Game after game he came, or whatever we played there. I was his only target. Oh, he was a specialist.
They pick you out. They choose you alone. That, more than anything, is why you hate them. Claude Luca.
He was deformed, that's what I remember. Lost one of his hands in an accident, plus part of the other. Well, he was deformed on the inside and out.
Many times I ignored him. Whole games, whole series. I shouted back, but I never crossed that ring. How would it look, me going after a crippled man? I held myself back.
And then he thought of something new to say.
He should never have said it.
He should never have thought he could get away with saying it.
He should have known. I'm a Georgian. He should have known.
He called me
a half nigger. Oh, I went over that rail and hell out of trouble. We have to get that man.
12 rows.
12 rows!
I went like a shot. This rope is big and wide as the moon.
I was bigger than him. I was stronger than him. And damn it, I was better than him. I punched him. I threw him down.
I kicked him. I never kicked that other fella. I kicked Claude Luca.
I kicked him. Oh, I kicked hard.
Nobody could pull me off of him.
And suddenly someone screamed, "Stabby, he has no hands."
I never paused. I just kicked
him. I shouted back,
"I don't care if he has no feet."
I should never have remembered that.
Why? Because it made me feel so right.
I was not right.
Hell, I wasn't! You think I was right, don't you? Oh, the crowd will always side with the cripple. But if I wasn't right, why did every one of my Tiger teammates back what I've done? Men who didn't even like me.
They were my teammates.
They hated my guts. When I got suspended for that fight, they walked off the field for me. Held the first ever Wildcat strike in baseball on my account.
Manager had to have local semi-pro and college players to wear our uniforms and play the athletics in our place. Athletics beat them 24-2. And I guess that taught everybody.
More important, every congressman from Georgia wired me with congratulations. The mayor and police chief of Atlanta both supported me. The police chief said if I hadn't done what I'd done,
I'd have lost the respect of every decent man in the country.
In 1912 in this country, you knew where people stood.
March 31st, 1917.
Hold on.
Why, we're just getting rolling. March 31st, 1917.
Stop it now. Don't you see what this is doing? He just loves it, that Charleston. Didn't you hear him? I will not permit an unbalanced view. It's that damn simple. I did not just fight people. I loved. Gave away money. Near the end. And I had friends and family. I was a normal man. Who's going to remember me if they think I was a monster? They'll toss me away. They'll keep Ruth. That's what they'll do. Him, they'll remember for centuries. Me? He's the one. He's the goddamn mountain.
It's not easy for me to throw. I played big league ball for 10 years before Ruth showed up. By then, I was king. I'd already won 8 straight batting titles. Hell, in 1911, Shoeless Joe Jackson hit 408, and I still beat him for the title with 420. I even led the league in homers once. Had 9 one year and was proud of every one of them. And in 1920, Ruth hit 54. 54 home runs. No one had ever come near that. Overnight, people went crazy for home runs. They went crazy for him, too. Didn't matter if I could do everything there was to do in the game. As far as the fans were concerned, he only had to do one thing.
God, how they loved him. They stared into that stupid meat face of his and saw something. Not intelligence, I'll tell you that. I mean, if you had a company to run, who would you pick to run it? Him or me? No contest.
So what the hell was it? Not good manners, and not sobriety neither. Now, Ruth wasn't guilty of any form of clean living.
What made people think of that face? Only that face and nothing more whenever you mention baseball. What on earth did he have?
Charm.
Bad timing. Son of a bitch hit his stride right after World War I. Probably the baseball got livelier, more fans were coming in, more parks were being built.
Location. That's what it was. In 1920, the Red Sox sold him to the Yankees. One thing to be the best, but to be the best in New York.
When you analyze it, when you really analyze it, what exactly did he offer? I mean, look at a typical trip to the plate for Babe Ruth. What happens? He takes a cut, hits a home run, trots his way around the base path like a big cow without a thought in his head. That's no trip around the bases.
I'll show you a trip around the bases, Cobb style. Starts with you carefully chosen words to the opposing pitcher. You know, things like,
"Hey, Randall, that can't be your fastball. You sure you're not a left-hander?"
You make him feel bad enough about one of his pitches, you can bet that's what he's going to throw you next time.
Then you decide which way you're going to hit it. If there's a man on, you want to pull. Hit behind him. So you bring that left hand down and you swing away.
When it does, this guy's fast and he's not. But you wouldn't go to him to give him the fastball in the first place. You bring your right hand up and you punch it the other way.
Either way, you hit a liner. Not some soft, lazy, high flyer that flops into the stand somewhere. No. Hit a bullet. You sizzle it past the pitcher's ear. Terrify the man. Make him forget all about women. Make him glad just to be alive.
Even though you got a base hit, you run to first like you're legging out a triple.
Oh, just the sight of speed can demoralize the other team. You're fast with your body. It stands to reason you're fast with your mind. Otherwise, you'd slow down and not get hurt.
Once you're on first, you start to systematically destroy the pitcher's mind. It's not hard. If he had much of a mind, he wouldn't be a pitcher. Hell, if Fate himself was a pitcher to begin with, I'd hit 326 off him.
You take a lead off first.
A big lead, so he'll throw over.
And he does. And you dive back, and you just make it.
All the rubes in the stands think he got the best of that one. But he didn't.
Well, he saw his best move.
You mentioned it. You can predict him now.
When he does that little thing, or whatever it is, makes that tiny, unconscious gesture. That means he's going home and not the first.
You take off.
Use the best speed in the league, tearing for second base.
When that catcher sees you go, his heart turns to a cinder. Because he knows you already got the base full on the pitcher's move.
But he knows he's got to throw it anyway, so not to look like a coward.
No mercy for cowards.
So he throws to second, and that ball is screaming in from home, and I'm screaming in from first. And sometimes I really am screaming. Everything there is to know about my spikes.
I sharpen my spikes on the dugout steps for all to see.
That's the legend.
And I like it.
He's gonna get that throw when he's gonna watch my spikes.
I'll cut him to pieces.
I've done it before.
Throws low, he jumps away too soon.
The ball goes into center field.
And I head for third.
That center fielder knows who I am. He's playing shallow. He's got to play on me at third. All he's got to do is throw it on the money, and I'll be out. He'll be, too. He's got a good arm.
So I look at the third baseman. I look at his eyes. He's getting ready. He sees me coming. He sees the ball. He watches the ball, and I watch his eyes.
And I line my body up with his eyes. So when that ball comes, it'll never get to him. It'll hit me in the back instead. It'll hit me, and I'll get my base.
Base pads belong to me.
They belong to me.
They're mine.
Safe to third on a single, but not home yet.
I look at the pitcher. His face is like the bottom of a metal bucket. He's not thinking anymore. He's not feeling either. I'm just doing things to him.
On the very next pitch, I take a long walking lead up third. When the pitcher goes home, so do I.
Oh, there's no pleasure in like stealing home. My wedding night was nothing compared to stealing home. It's just you, the ball, and the catcher. You can't beat the ball at home. If it's a decent pitch at all, you can't beat it to the plate. You gotta force your way up.
It's the catcher or you. That's what it is. It's a fight.
If he drops the ball, you're safe. But if he doesn't,
you gotta force your way in. You're gonna need to win him.
You gotta hit him. You gotta bruise him. You got to do anything. You gotta hit him, punch him, break his legs, stick your spikes in him. You got to score.
Stealing home. The most audacious move in baseball.
The complete destruction of the opposing team's ability to protect itself. And nobody did it better than me.
Now that is a trip around the bases. You can bet Babe Ruth never took that trip. No, I haven't could. I could hit home runs. I hit five in two games once. No, but he could never move around the bases. Like me.
Don't.
how you feel.
What's it to you?
I'm just curious, that's all. That's fine talking to you about Babe Ruth just now.
It's not about Babe Ruth, it's about me.
What's bothering you? What kind of pain you got?
Nothing.
Something's bothering you.
It's nothing. It's just a strawberry I got from Slide, that's all.
I used to get those. Rip your whole leg up Slide in the base. All the way from your knee to your head. Deals we played on. Who is lucky to have any skin left at all by seeing this end? How's bad the one you got?
Bad. Sometimes it don't hurt so much. Sometimes I... Okay.
You don't have to have it, you know.
What?
You don't have to have it. You just let it go now.
I won't.
Yep, you and me sure digging around the faces different than Babe.
What do you know about it?
Well, he had some Babe Ruth. Black Babe Ruth, they call him. Named Josh Gibson. You remember him? I'm proud to say I played with Josh. That man can hit a ball further than anybody I've ever seen, including Ruth. We had a black Lou Gehrig, too. Buck Leonard and John Jimmy Laurie, he was a black cornerback. Me, I was a black cop. Of course, we didn't get to pick who they compared us to, you understand? Just the man in the white league played the most night. Your position, your ability, your temper.
My temper?
I was a fighter, same as you. Joined the Army when I was 15, fought my way through that. Then fought my way through baseball. Joined my hometown club, the Indianapolis ABCs. Used to spike a lot of players. Why those players wouldn't even try to tag me out, they just step back. Love me still the base. I fought folks all the time. Wasn't just players either. I fought humps, hell. One time I punched the owner in the face. On the field, off the field. Didn't care where I fought. Hit a man in the shower one time just before the bad pitch in the game. Toughness. That's why I got the name of Black Cobb. That hitting over 400 most of the time. It wasn't the worst start, I suppose. It was the only way white folks knew me. They never even know Oscar Charleston. Just a black cop. You feeling comfortable? You resting easy now?
Get out of here.
I would if I could. I'd leave you all to yourselves. Don't seem to be able to, though. It's like you pull me to you. Wherever you are, I got to be. Feel like you're calling me all the time.
I'm not calling you.
Something is.
Something's calling me too, but I'll go around bopping other people about it. Now go on, get away from it.
Can't get away.
Then get back as far as you can.
Sure that's what you want? Can't go far. Maybe just out of sight. How's this?
Better.
When I was 21, I married a woman named Charlie.
No cracks.
We had 5 children. I was a family man. Good one, too.
We didn't get divorced till every one of those kids was grown.
It's true, we had our problems, but we also had a sense of decency. I didn't chase after women like a lot of ball players. I slept with a gun, not other women. It was a hell of a lot safer.
Once I retired, I was home a lot more. After a while, things got unpleasant.
My marriage was no worse than anyone else's.
How do you make a wife love you? How do you do that?
Charlie loved me.
Always? Marriage was created so even the greatest of men would have an opportunity to fail.
I did not fail with her.
I what?
I loved her when we were married. She was barely 17. Something happens to you when you're in love. You lose all sense of how to do things. I left the Tigers during the middle of a pennant race to marry Charlie. I took the train all the way down to Georgia. 3-day trip. Got to Charlie's folks' house 1 minute before the ceremony. And there she was. standing there in lace and flowers, looking like the answer to every question that had ever been asked. The local newspaper said our wedding was marked by that simplicity, which is the keynote of excellence. I thought fans were going to be mad about that. They weren't, though. They stood and cheered. Next 2 weeks, my bad man will slip 20 points. Can't tell you what sweetness it was being with her back then, stop now. Still, sometimes I think I knew even then, right in the middle of all that, the first pleasure, that it would die.
There's no hope in life. When you're young, you do things by instinct, blind. Other people get married. Other people have children.
By the time you know what you're doing, you already done it. Wrong. There is no feeling that compares with living in a dead marriage.
Years of endless companionship.
Watching her turn the children against me. My oldest son like tennis, for God's sake. Tennis. Tyrus Raymond Cobb Jr. He hated baseball.
He didn't hate it. He just had trouble.
He had trouble with everything. Flopped around in school for years. Flunked out of Princeton. Flunked out of Yale. Didn't get a profession until he was over 30. And then look what he became. A gynecologist.
The son of Ty Cobb. A gynecologist. Try telling that to your friends at an old-timers game.
I barely spoke to him for 15 years. My own son.
Let it go.
Charlie made him like that. My wife encouraged every lazy, self-interested urge he had.
Let it go. When he was 42, he died. Brain cancer. Near the end, I made up with him. He left a wife and three children. I used to visit them.
My younger son, Herschel, died the year before. Heart attack.
Two sons in 2 years. Great lives suffer great tragedies.
So do common ones.
What the hell use is a family that falls apart on? I put 39 years into that marriage. Every one of my children sided with their mother. Where's the justice in that, eh? What league did she ever be bitten? When did she ever make $1 million?
In the divorce, that's when.
Divorced in 1947. Charlie hired some young son of a bitch lawyer named Melvin Bellhead to claim I was worth $14 million.
It was a damn lie. I wasn't that rich. We settled out of court. Terms of the agreement were never revealed, ever, to anyone. So you can all take your curiosity.
God, I loved her. She had hazel eyes. She was a southern lady.
When we were through, I was calling her that old woman.
Great lives suffer great tragedies.
Hey, good to see you.
What are you doing?
Me? Getting ready for some Cuban ball. Used to go down there all the time, make some winter money, enjoy the sunshine, not a bad life. Lots of players in school, black and white.
Not me.
Not Edel?
Nope.
That ain't what I heard. Heard the Titans went down in 1910, and you were with them.
Doesn't mean I played.
Oh, you played. I heard from John Henry Lloyd and Bruce Pettaway both, and they were there. We played against Cuban American blacks, 1910. 5 games.
What the hell's it matter if I did?
Don't matter at all. Heard you hit blew up in those games. 400, something like that.
Probably. I don't recall.
Tell me, how come you never played against black players again? Is it because Bruce Pettaway blew you out trying to steal a second? That's what Bruce always figured. Big getting thrown out by a black catcher like him bothered you something awful. Shouldn't have. Bruce is a fine catcher. He threw us all out one time or another. Sure shot. Just once. That'd been a real honor. I enjoyed that.
Can we change the subject?
Of course we can. I'm just surprised you passed it up. All that good money down there, Cuba.
I was not responsible for the color bar in baseball.
Never said you were.
You're here, aren't you? Colors were forced out of the major leagues before I was born. You want to haunt somebody, you go haunt to Cap Anson. You go haunt to Spalding or Comiskey, Landis. They made the decisions, not me. There is a time and a place for everything. The place for you was Brooklyn. The time was 1947. It's as simple as that.
Maybe you're right. Only problem is, I stopped playing in 1937. To play against you, just once. We had a real
honor. I never objected to Collins playing. You hear me? Never! I was exactly like everybody else.
I played in 3 World Series in my life.
3 World Series in a row, actually, Em. Em. Sam.
What?
Oh, we lost Oliver.
I don't deny it.
Besides, you could look it up.
Well, so what? So we lost. Lots of great players never even saw a World Series. I got there 3 times.
And lost.
He had a good team. He always went flat at the finish.
Tigers. My Tigers. Lost 3 World Series. 3 consecutive years.
The only team ever to do that.
It was a failure.
Losing 3 World Series.
Well, good. I admit it. Let's go on.
When I first told my father I wanted to be a ball player, it's like telling him I want to be a vagrant.
What are you talking about now?
We argued over it for a long time. Then I had a chance to play for a team over in Alabama. Semi-pro, probably paid you enough. He let me go. All my life, it'd been like a glass mountain. Yeah, you couldn't climb it. You always saying no, demanding more. And then suddenly there it was, saying, go on, go to Alabama, try baseball. Well, him, it must have been like saying, go on, go try letting him climb.
He said one more thing, too. He said, don't come home a failure.
That's not important.
Hell, it ain't.
He was dead before he knew it was a failure, not. Nah, he wasn't dead to me, though. I might have been a 280 hitter if he hadn't said those words to me. It's easy, you know? Just let your concentration slip. As it was, I hit 367 for my career. Over 24 years, 367.
That's the highest of anybody by far ever.
Don't come home a failure.
Most hits, most runs scored, most stolen bases season, most stolen bases career, most triples, most singles. Records I held for 50 years, longer some of them. Most records.
At one time, I held 90 records. 90!
Don't come home a failure!
Shut the hell up.
I had to get every hit I could. I had to steal every base.
How do you please a dead man?
It wasn't a matter of that.
Could I take any joke lightly? Those men knew I wanted their jobs. They knew I was going to get them. There was no joke.
Roomed alone on the road. Never was alone, though.
Don't come home a failure. My father shouldn't have come home at all one night.
Get out of here. Now. Get out! I competed over everything in life, it's true. Over matters of no importance. I once played a golf match against Babe Ruth. Betty Davis presented the award. I treated it like the World Series. I hated myself like that. Couldn't stand myself. But I never, never changed.
You know, I always thought as I grew old, I'd become, you know, wiser and kinder.
I didn't.
I just found myself developing more and more into myself.
You see what happens when you don't let me choose the topic of conversation? I mean, this is ridiculous. Why should I be depressed after what I've done in life? Hell, I've done so much I can't. Who was the first professional athlete in America to star in a feature motion picture?
Oh, Cobb!
That's right, me. In 1916, I had the lead in a movie written by Franklin Rice. It was called... Come on. It was called...
It was called Somewhere in Georgia. That's about a young Georgia ball player who played for the Detroit Tigers.
You could say it was tailored for me.
I'm leaving.
Leaving?
Yeah, let me know when you're remembering a fight.
Wait a minute. Wait now. This is important. This is my festive side. I'd acted before you. I toured on the living stage as Billy Bolton, the handsome halfback, in a play called The College Winner.
Lots of ball players acted in vaudeville in the offseason, but I held out for a real character in a real play. It paid better.
I got good reviews, especially in the South where it counted. Oh, one son of a bitch in Birmingham. I fixed him. Sent him all my good reviews, plus a note.
I'm a better actor than you are. I'm a better drama critic than you are. I make more money than you do, and I know I'm a better ball player. So why should inferiors criticize superiors? That's what I wrote. Dave Bradley still feels terrible. I should have killed him.
That's the whole problem with this country. We hold things in too much. We should let them out. Fight when we have to.
We can't always.
These are some of my fights.
No fights.
I beat up an umpire under the grandstand. That one's a lie, but I'll claim it anyway.
I told you.
Nearly fought Ruth once in 1924. Took both teams to keep us apart.
I'm going.
Pulled a gun on my butcher.
I did no such
thing. Threw my bat in the stand protesting a call.
Never.
Don't
you see what this does? How do you want to be remembered?
As dangerous.
As a liar. June 1908.
Now look what you've done.
June 1908. Fred Collins, last street worker, that was some asphalt he was laying down. He yelled at you and hit him.
Why should I want to remember that one?
Oh, I'm sorry. Thought you did.
Besides, I barely touched him.
He filed charges.
Let it be. You just go on. If I hit him, I hit him. No need to remember it.
If he'd have been white, he'd have been honored I touched him at all. Couldn't believe it when the judge found me guilty.
He suspended the sentence, though.
Yeah, even he could tell a rich man from a poor man.
You still paid $75.
Yeah, and I miss it to this day.
No need to go into all this. It was an isolated incident.
September 1909.
What's wrong with that one?
Nothing. Got in a fight with a night watchman in Cleveland, that's all.
And he was colored. What do you want to make of it?
Nothing. He doesn't want to make anything of it.
George Stansfield, I remember him. They pulled a club on me.
You pulled a knife on him.
Well, he pulled a gun.
You cut him.
And I'd do it again. He practically killed me with that club.
It was you got convicted.
God damn it, I'll
stop it.
You got no right, you hear me? You got no right to bring my life up to me. I'm tired.
Let it go.
Tired of screaming, Cobb. I had fights.
I was drunk those times.
I was stone cold sober. I fought colors with my fists. I was only doing what other whites did in other ways. The country I grew up in hated colors. It hated them, and by God, it feared them, and it still does. Don't you point me up to some kind of special person on that score. I wasn't.
You're right. Nothing special about you.
You know what I mean!
Assault and battery. That's what it was. They fined me $100 in costs. I tell you, the courts of Ohio have degenerated sharply. You know, I help colored folks too now, man. I did. Built housing for them down in Georgia. It wasn't charity. I made money on it. Built for them all the same.
We have a colored mascot on the team. You know, a bat boy. The one when I gave my job down by Cobb dealership in Augusta. Cleaner or something.
I lied. I was never greatly criticized for my attitude toward the color. Except by colored newspapers, and they were biased.
Let's not fight. Just once, let's not.
You know, it's hard being the best in something. Gives you that nervous feeling, like there's no one left to fight against. No way to get any better. As good as you can be, as good as you need to be. The world almost favors a man like that. Nothing could beat him. Nothing but time.
I'll beat time!
Sure you can try.
He's right.
What do you mean he's right?
He's right. What chance is there against time? Eat you up whole. 42 years old and I was finished. What good was I to anyone when I retired?
What good? What good? I hit 323 my last year. Could have gone on forever. Had plenty of fight left in me. Still do.
That's the problem.
My God. Sometimes I can't believe how old I got.
When I was 42, I left baseball. The next 33 years, I spent with someone who couldn't do the one thing that made me special. I could get richer, I could hunt, I could have children I didn't understand. A wife who loved me less and less. I could go to old-timers' meetings, dinners, give interviews, but I could never again feel triumph. My wife, Dolly, and I bought a retirement home in Abbott, California. Spent 15 years there, during which she filed 4 divorce suits. The last one quit. The place had 7 bedrooms, swimming pool, guest house, servants' quarters, grounds. God, I hated it. Once she was gone, I didn't know what I was supposed to do with myself. I fished, hunted, made more money, gambled, wrote condescending articles about baseball today. Got drunk and insulted people. Kept a son of a bitch list. Sued people. Between sat, stared. When my cancer came, the only thing that would hold the pain down was a 50% solution of Jack Daniels and Hildeck. And that was me at the end. Sick man shambling around in his dope roll ball day, drinking that. Loneliness is the main road of life. The rest is just a detour. Hell, loneliness isn't even the road. It's the land itself. This country was built on loneliness. It is loneliness.
I think married people should see each other only occasionally. You know, immediate weddings, funerals, that sort of thing. You know, men and women don't like living the same way. Why should they pretend they do?
We should all live alone. We only meet once in a while in the dark. Then at least we'd have an excuse for lying down wondering the hell this was while next was.
Proudest day of my life. Saddest day of my life. The day was inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame. I was there the day the place opened. First man ever voted in. Al Cole, Babe Ruth. Ernest Wagner. Cy Young. Walter Johnson. Christy Mathis. Chris Speaker. Nat Ridgway. Lee Willie Keeler. George Sisler. Eddie Collins. Grover Cleveland Alexander.
No man who ever played got more votes than me. We were all there, too. The one still living. That's Connie Mack. We've been the greatest in the game. Now we were a bunch of old men sitting in folding chairs. Something horrifying about seeing athletes you knew 30 years ago all wasted away, like having a dozen mirrors around you.
The mirrors are all you have. So you go, summer after summer, back to that ceremony in Columbus now. The banquet.
You drink. You visit with men who grow older and older.
Sitting in the folding chairs.
Greatest players of our time, out of time.
Drink a little more. Tell the worn-out stories.
Drink a little more.
Let the night steal over you. People leave all around you.
You don't even notice that you're last. Talking with one other man, or maybe a young man, someone who works there, someone assigned to see that you're all right.
Someone belts you up the street, teetering, more for drink than age. Under the stars in the summer night in your hotel.
And you think this moment
is the purest heaven.
The purest hell I will ever know.
People say I was the most intelligent player in the game. But I felt things too. Whenever I walked into a ballpark, it was like falling in love for the first time, again and again. And as though you could do that. And the feel of the glove and the bat. I mean, these objects that were always there between you and the other man. Well, they were tools you used, but they were also a part of your body. They made me feel more natural, more physically complete. Time's fault, not mine. I traded him in for a Luger and a bag full of money.
Damn it, that's enough. The hell with all this moment. So what if I had it bad at the end? Who doesn't? We all break down. It's what we do before, that's the point. I did more than anybody. Hell, I played poker with presidents. Don't you dream of pitying me. What's that doing there? Get rid of that! Get rid of it! You fat son of a bitch, you couldn't touch me, you hear? You were no damn match! You wouldn't have left me one night in the hotel concert train! I tell you that! Hotel concert train in Detroit. Or the Oak Bar in the Hotel concert train. That's where I went, the Oak Bar. Not to drink, but to listen. Certain rich and powerful men came to that bar. Men with names like Olds, Packard, Chevrolet, the Stanley Steamer Twins, men who ran Hudson, Huckmobile, and Dodge. No city in America boomed the way Detroit did in those years. The entire automobile industry was growing up like some enormous baby. Utterly selfish, utterly determined. Deals flew around that room. Tips! All you had to do was sit at the end of the bar and listen. They told you what to do. Where were all my teammates then, eh? Where were the know-it-all sports writers? Down the street in some newspaper bar, getting stiff while I was getting rich. By listening. By using the same brain I used on the field. That's why I'm special. It's the money I made. It's the way I made it. It's my brain. My instinct to dominate and destroy those around me. Just like everybody else!
Babe Ruth wouldn't have known how to use the 05 at the Hotel Pontchartrain. Hell, he would have ended up under it. Ruth was a freak. He was an egg on stilts. But you loved him, you know. Late in life, I sometimes drove by Ruth's old apartment on Riverside Drive in New York. I used to go up there after games when we played the Yankees. Ruth and I would sit for hours and talk. He'd eat about a half dozen sandwiches and smoke a cigar. The sun would set over the Hudson. He'd chomp away and talk with me, and I was his best friend. Never saw a man who looked so much like he belonged in the world.
Was that?
This is the Pittsburgh Croppers.
What's a Cropper?
Damn it, show respect. This was a great team.
You play on a lot of teams?
Chicago American Giants, Philadelphia Hilldales, Pittsburgh Croppers, Indianapolis ABCs, Harrisburg Giants, Philadelphia Stars, plus the Homestead Braves, and a few Cuban teams.
Well, you must have been good. Everybody wanted to keep you so bad.
I played wherever team had money. Most of us changed rounds quite a bit. Didn't matter, though. We knew who we were. We knew how good we were. The best ever to play the game.
Damn it, quit saying that. There's no comparison and you know it.
There ain't. What's the best team you ever played on?
Best team?
Most successful. What years?
1908 Tigers, I suppose. No, 1909.
Who are the stars? Tell me the names.
the stars. Me? Wahoo Sam Crawford.
Wahoo?
Donnie Bush.
Bushley.
Davy Jones.
Fishbait.
George Mullen.
Nothing.
How the hell do you know?
My best team was 1932 Crawfords. Player for player, we got your wit. We had Josh Gibson, cool Papa Bell, Judy Johnson, Satchel Paige, and me. That's five right there in the Hall of Fame. Coming from that Tiger team of yours, two. Sometimes I think the majors have been a step down from where I played.
Oh, it's that name they put on you, isn't it? The Black Cobb. You got that, you start thinking all sorts of things.
I don't need a name to know how good I am. Don't need people to call me the Black Cobb or not. No one, you need me to call you the White Charleston.
Son of a bitch.
I made that list now, huh?
What is it you want? Why don't you get the hell out of my dream?
Maybe it ain't just your dream. You know what I want? I want to see that part of your mind that felt happy the first time you heard about the Black Cobb. That felt lucky, that was glad that you weren't a black man, the Black Cobb, all tucked out of sight the Negro League. I want to see that part of your mind that felt fine right then. I want to hold that in my hand. I want to look at it. I want to see what kind of thing that is.
Come on! You felt the same thing. Every time you swung a bat, every time you saw an average ball player, thank God I'm me. Thank God I got a built-in advantage. You're no different than me. You're the same as me.
Nice to hear you say
that. You know what I mean!
You and me, we play those average ball players. They had the same chances we did on the same field. You never gave me that chance.
When could I have played you?
1915, 1922, 1923, three different years of Tigers. Your Tigers played exhibition ball against teams I played on. Three different chances, three different Octobers. You could have been there, you never were. You'll never be able to say, I played Oscar Charleston. I played the Black Cobb, and I was better.
Son of a bitch.
Say it again.
Son of a bitch.
That's right, I'm a son of a bitch.
You are a son of a bitch.
Say it again.
Son of a bitch.
Say it forever. All you had to do was play me once. I'd have left you alone. Now, I'm going to be with you forever.
Son of a bitch.
Say goodbye to your record books, too. Without us in your league, the record books don't exist.
Son of a bitch.
Again.
Son of a bitch.
Again. How many times you reckon you said it in your lifetime? You're so tired of saying you can't get the words out your mouth. It's the same for me. Life is full of son of bitches. But you know the biggest son of bitch of all? When it disappears. What you say, what you did, people you love, people you hate. When it wears out, fades away. Places you played, the times you lived in. Things you had a right to. That happened to you the day you died. It happened to me the first day. First time I walked onto a field, put my hand in the glove, held the bat. Everything was there for me and nothing was there. You worried about being erased? You should have been me. I was alive and dead at the same time. You don't mean a damn to me. You've been swallowed up along with everything else. You leave no mark. You think anger can save you? You don't know what anger is. They put me in the Hall of Fame in 1976. Forget me the minute my plaque is on the wall.
You should never have spoken to me. That's how trouble always comes. From going where there's no reason to go.
November 1896. In the fifth grade, I beat up a fat boy. See, he missed a word in the spelling contest and made us boys lose to the girls. But I had to beat him up. My first fight, I remember. Real one, anyway. With blood. Oh, the way that first punch I connected with made me feel pleasure and terror all at once. Kids all screamed. I mean, surrounded by screaming kids. In the eye of the storm. A storm I could create myself anytime out of pure need. Out of pure need.
When they opened the Hall of Fame in 1939, the first thing they put in was a pair of shoes. My shoes. My Spikes. The first single of baseball to enter that building.
They didn't have to choose him. Babe Ruth had plenty of stuff lying around, but they chose my spots. That's because they truly knew the game.
What's it matter? Ruth was the game. You should have seen people when Babe Ruth died. Sure, he died young, but still.
The whole city of New York wept. The whole nation.
When I went, I just went.
Article in the Times. Cobb, was he still alive?
Good myth should go out with more than that.
Ty Cobb died of cancer when he was old and unconscious.
I've been a part of baseball for over 50 years. Only two major leaguers came to my funeral. The town had to get a bunch of little leaguers to line the way. Shit.
Most hated man in baseball.
My father died better than me.
I'll never make a myth.
I was too real for myths. You couldn't sell what I was. I'm buried in Georgia. This is where I really lie. First thing inside the Hall of Fame. Not a bat. Not a ball. My spikes. I put my spikes somewhere else, too. And you. And every one of you.
Germany Schaefer. He was a tiger. Way back, Mike. My God, I don't remember anymore. Back when I was starting out. He once did something on the ball field I never did understand. Well, he stole first base. Well, that's right, he was standing on second base and he just suddenly let out a woohoo! The pitcher was too amazed to even make a throw. I always thought he did that to drive the opposition crazy. You know, not let him know what was coming at him next. That's not why I did it, though. It was for love. He just loved the game. Strangest thing I ever saw.
I built a hospital. I created the Cobb Educational Fund. I provided for my heirs better than most men could imagine. Once I was gone, my hometown of Royston built a Ty Cobb Museum. They were gonna have a bronze statue of him, too. They had to cancel that for lack of funds. The museum itself closed eventually for lack of visitors. No man wants to be forgotten. Every man, if he breathes, wants someone to remember that fact. No shame in it. Perfectly human aspiration. I was the quickest, meanest, smartest, fiercest, best man ever to play the game. Just remember.
fantastic. You are the best audience that we've had so far.
Right.
Coming. Tonight was our last show, but hopefully we will be, hopefully we'll be doing it again. As was mentioned in the opening of the show, a portion of the proceeds of the donations, that is, of this particular show are going to be going out to the Negro League Hall of Fame. They are opening up a new building out there because nobody needs or deserves to be forgotten.
They'll always be remembered.
Yes.
Very interested in what happened here, so you'll be a part of their history too out there.
And the program is going into the Hall of Fame.
The Hole in the Wall Theater is run entirely by donation, so like nobody cuts a check, nobody gets paid. It's all just to keep the theater going. So all of the donations go to just keeping the theater itself open. The way that Hole in the Wall works is it's every 2 weeks on a Wednesday. The next one coming up is October 29th. They have a general meeting. And anyone who steps foot in the door becomes a voting member.
That's how I got in.
You're pretty lucky.
You can vote yourself in.
That's right.
And let's see, the next show going on is called Greetings. It's a kind of a comedy drama comedy. It's called Greetings. It's running from November 21st to December 20th.
Right.
And so please, if you enjoyed this show, you'll probably enjoy other Hole in the Wall productions. So please come to that one as well. And this month was the birthday of Oscar McKinley Charleston. So at the end, are we having pizza tonight?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
At the end of tonight's
and
show,
the pizza's
please
free.
Stick around.
You
didn't we have pizza, that. We have drinks.
I forgot to tell you not to eat when you called for breakfast.
And also, we have a basket out in the lobby that goes direct, the donations to that go directly to the Negro League Hall of Fame. And we also have a basket, so anyone who would like to contribute more to the Hole in the Wall directly through us, there's also a basket for that out there. And
Halloween party, did you get
there's
that?
A Halloween party. I have not mentioned that yet. On November 1st, it is a Hole in the Wall fundraiser. It's $5, and please, it is costumes, so please.
If you can't go to Kansas City, come to the
yes.
Halloween party.
So, and if you come in costume. It's a fundraiser for the Hole in the Wall. It costs $5, and there'll be food, drinks, et cetera. So, and is there anything?
This being our closing show, Lester, go ahead.
Okay, I'm going to sing happy birthday to Oscar first.
What day was
he would have been
October 14th.
He would have been 101 years old.
It's become a tradition for us now.
Okay, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Oscar. Four shows you've been having an Oscar Charleston's birthday party. That's right. All right. What's the old adage? For every great man, there's a great woman. Well, we have
a bunch of great women, and we'd like to acknowledge them now.
Yes.
The women behind Cobb. Here we go. Year awards we'd like to give as the cast.
This is a little bit of a tradition in some of the theaters I've been in. The cast gives awards to the director and the stage manager, provided they're worth it, and they've been well worth it. So the cast is presenting to Alice Papineau, the director of the year award. The Stage Manager of the Year Award.
Dave, I'm telling you, don't get paid, Dave.
I don't get paid.
Play ball.
I guess that's pretty much
play
all.
Play ball and eat.
Yes, we have pizza. And thank you again for coming. Give yourself.
Turn of the century, I took a rustic folk art form called baseball and applied the science of warfare to it. Fit like a damn glove, you gotta believe. That's my contribution to America. That's what you owe me. I know these things for three reasons. I'm dead, I'm a millionaire, and I'm in the Hall of Fame.
When I was 16, I helped a doctor take a bullet out of a nigger some white boy shot. I was trying to decide if I wanted to go into medicine. Dr. Moss had me give the boy chloroform and feel around the inside of him. Found the bullet. Couldn't though. But now look at Dr. Moss. We sewed him up again. He lived okay, I guess. My hands were covered in just blood. I felt all through. Lord, I wanted to faint and throw up all at the same time. Never became a doctor. I guess you can see that. Blazing so blood.
To know me. Maybe you'd like to study my unique handbook. It's a secret to my success, along with the fact that I'm the most talented man ever played.
Most talented?
See, I hold the hands apart. Then as I swing, I move one hand toward the other, depending if I'm hitting the right or the left. Now, if you never played the game before, you don't know what I'm talking about. And if you have, well, you can't do it as well as me anyway. So don't try to analyze it. Just remember, it's part of my myth.
A great myth needs a great beginner.
You never gave me that chance.
When could I have played you?
1915, 1922, 1923, three different years of Tigers. Your Tigers played exhibition ball against teams I played on. Three different chances, three different Octobers. You could have been there. You never were. You'll never be able to say, I played Oscar Charleston. I played the Black Cobb. And I was better.
You son of a bitch.
Back around the turn of the century, a young man came up from the minor leagues. He was a little bit pitbull and part piranha. They said, please play fair. He said, I don't want to. Used to sharpen up his spikes before every game. He went from felonious assault to the Hall of Fame. Hey, Ty Cobb, we remember you. Oh, the year was 1912, when the Georgia Peach went to the stands and beat the heck out of a heckler who didn't even have any hands. He was an imposing figure when he stood at the plate. Sometimes you don't have to be good to be great. Hey, Ty Cobb, we remember you. 1911, he was MVP, but during his whole career, he was an SOB. He was a prolific hitter in more ways than one. He had 4,191 hits before his career was done. And for 22 years, he was the pride of the Detroit franchise. And those allegations that he fixed games never materialized. He retired in 1928 and died in 1962. Just 6 months before Pete Rose made his National League debut. Hey, Ty Cobb, we remember you. And maybe Babe Ruth's in heaven, out in right field. Luke Gehrig's in heaven at first base. Cy Young's in heaven, standing tall on the mound. And Ty Cobb, well, he's probably in another place. But hey, Ty Cobb, we remember you. Sometimes the people we recognize most in history were just rotten through and through. Hey, Ty Cobb, we remember you. Hey, Ty Cobb, we remember you. Back around the turn. Thank you.